it's all so plain to me. We need a revival, no doubt, where we all pray through and testify just how the Lord came by. Hey, hey, now that's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. Let's all sing and shout. Pray till the latter rain falls down, down, down. Clap our hands and sing along to those old camp meeting songs. Hey, hey, now that's what I'm talking about. Well, it wasn't all that long ago. Conviction fell and gripped our soul. We could feel the power all around. And the saints of old would shout the aisles. Looking back, it makes me smile. Hey, hey, now that's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. But let's all sing and shout. Pray till the latter rain falls down, down, down. Clap our hands and sing along to those old camp meeting songs. Hey, hey, now that's what I'm talking about.
Come on, saints, amen. Put your hands together.
We'll clap our hands and sing along to those old camp meeting songs. Hey, hey, now that's what I'm talking about.
I'm talking about,
talking about,
talking about.
That's what I'm talking about.
I'm talking about,
talking about.
That's what I'm talking about.
Come on, give the Lord a clap offering tonight. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Lord knows I'm guilty of living my life like there's always tomorrow for making things right. But our days are numbered like the hairs on our head, and no man knows the hour he's gonna shake hands with us.
You don't have to go
home and live up in glory, but you can live forever down here. For all in this world that's uncertain, one thing is clear: you don't have to go home, but you can stay here. There's a master timekeeper who died on the cross, and it breaks his heart knowing hell's gain is his loss. But if your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you'll know where you're going if he calls you tonight. You don't have to go home and live up in glory, but you can live forever.
forever down here.
For all in this world that's uncertain, one thing is clear. You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here. For all in this world that's uncertain, one thing is clear. You don't have to go home, but you can stay here.
What a joy and a privilege it is for Crandall Brothers to be here tonight at White Well. Thank you for the invitation, Pastor David. It's good to see you again. It's been 2 years ago since we were here last, and it's just a privilege and a delight to be here. We come from California. Anybody knows where that's at? Well, two of you do. How about the rest of you? All right. And we're just delighted to be here. Just a couple of more songs we'd like to do for you tonight. And I start talking about Jesus, I could just go on and on. But you know what? We'll sing about him tonight instead. And the song says, don't get me started, because if you do, we might be here for a while. If you got plans to go somewhere, you might want to go do them, because when we start talking about the Lord, it's just a wonderful subject, isn't it? All right. Listen to the words that says, don't get me started. All right. You can clap along, too, if you'd like. All right.
Where do I begin to even try to count my blessings? If you ask me, I got more than I can share. Oh, where do I jump in to tell you all about God's goodness? And this could take a while, so you better be prepared.
Don't get me started on what the Lord has done for me. Don't get me started on what it means to be set free. Cause when I start, I can't stop singing about the joy the Lord keeps bringing.
Let me warn you, if there's somewhere you need to be,
where you need to be, don't get me started on what the Lord has done for me.
Yeah. Well, I'm not good at summing up this never-ending storm. With every dawn, His mercy is brand new. I wish I could describe for you the wonders of His glory. But even if I tried, who knows when I'd get through?
Don't get me started on what the Lord has done for me. Don't get me started on what it means to be set free. Cause when I start, I can't stop singing about the joy the Lord keeps bringing.
Let me warn you, if there's somewhere you need to be,
where you need to be, don't get me started on what the Lord has done for me.
Have I told you how He saved me? Have I said how He forgave me?
Did I mention where He found me? How He loosed those chains that bound me?
I can never overstate it.
I can never exaggerate it.
Did you know He's gonna take me to a home? He's gonna make me.
Don't get me started on what the Lord has done for me. Don't get me started on what it means to be set free. Cause when I start, I can't stop singing about the joy the Lord keeps ringing.
Let me warn you, if there's somewhere you need to be,
where you need to be, don't get me started on what the Lord has done for me.
Cause when I start, I can't stop singing about the joy the Lord keeps bringing. Let me warn you, if there's somewhere you need to be,
where you need to be, don't get me started on what the Lord has done for me. No, 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 don't get me started.
Thank you, so kind. We've certainly enjoyed our stay here in Northern Ireland, and It's just been so beautiful. We left home, and it was 102 degrees where we live. And when we got over here to Ireland, we said we're just going to stay here and not go back home where the weather is pleasant. We praise the Lord for that. And the hospitality has been just great. And thank you for letting us come and sing and minister to you tonight. What a joy it is to see you here. Praise the Lord. We are the Crandall Brothers. This is Mr. Ken Edwards over here. Would you make him welcome, please, our baritone singer? The gentleman in the middle is Dale Durant. He sings our second tenor. Please make him welcome. And I'm the only Crandall left in the group. There were four Crandall brothers that started in 1969. This is our 50th year that we're celebrating ministry and music. And I'm glad to be here, too. I think it's only fair that you give them a hand, that you give me one. So come on. All right. I often think, where would I be without Jesus tonight? And I'm pretty sure that I would be out there in the world fulfilling the lust of the flesh. But I'm glad that one day the sweet convicting power of the Holy Spirit came and convicted me of what I was and what I am. And Jesus so graciously saved me and set me free. I fear, and when I think about what I would be without him. And so this song talks about that, if not for the love of Christ. God bless you as we sing it. Praise the Lord.
Looking back over the years that I've known, if I had made this journey alone, I'd be searching for meaning so empty inside, if not for the love of Christ. Now I could pretend that I'm satisfied, make you believe I'm enjoying the ride, but the smile on my face would be a disguise if not for the love of Christ. The love of Christ, oh, the love of Christ. No finer treasure, no greater prize. I can't imagine living my life if not for the love of Christ. No mercy to cover all my mistakes, there'd be no peace in my darkest days, and no hope that I'd ever see paradise if not for the love of Christ. The love of Christ, oh, the love of Christ. No finer treasure, no greater prize. I can't imagine living my life if not for the love of Christ. If not for the
bless you. It was a Wednesday night you sang here last, wasn't it?
Wednesday night.
I remember that. God bless you. Thank you for ministering to us. God bless you. Amen. Praise the Lord. If you have a Bible with you tonight, will you quickly turn with me to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 14. My title tonight is, It Only Happens When You Take Your Eyes Off Jesus. It Only Happens when you take your eyes off Jesus. We're reading tonight from Matthew 14, verses 22 to 33. And this is one of the miracles of Jesus. There's approximately 38 recorded miracles that Jesus performed. And this is one of the most memorable that Matthew records in our reading tonight. So let's read, shall we? Matthew 14 and verse number 22. Immediately, Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. Now when evening came, he was alone there. But the boat was now in the middle of the sea, tossed by the waves, for the wind was contrary. Now in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a ghost." And they cried out for fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Be of good cheer. It is I. Do not be afraid." And Peter answered him and said, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." So he said, "Come." And when Peter had come down out of the boat, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. And when he saw that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, saying, "Lord, save me." And immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught him and said to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. Then those who were in the boat came and worshipped him, saying, "Truly, truly, you are the Son of God." We'll stop there. May the Lord bless to us that remarkable, that wonderful reading of his inspired record. Father, we thank you for our time already together. We ask you, Lord, let your word now live and come alive. And Lord, as we examine this miracle and this story tonight, Lord, I pray that its lessons, Lord, will be revealed to us. Will you speak to every heart and every life and every spirit and every soul? And Lord, should there be someone sinking tonight, Lord, may they cry out for thee. And may you stretch forth your hand tonight and save precious souls. We ask this and pray this. Jesus' precious name. Amen. The Greek philosopher Plato, who lived some 400 years before Jesus, on one occasion said these words, "Even if there is a supernatural realm, it does not intrude into our natural world." In other words, he was saying nothing of a supernatural nature ever happens in our world. Plato, you are wrong. You are wrong tonight because Jesus happened. And much of what is associated with him was supernatural. So the supernatural did invade, and the supernatural did intrude into our natural world. For much of the Christian age, Christianity rejected Plato's view. But in the 19th century and the 20th century, some European churchmen foolishly, erroneously embraced Plato's lie, and they began to apply it to the pages
of Holy Scripture. Everything supernatural in the Bible, they rejected. And in its place, they offered instead a natural explanation. When they came to the four Gospels, the likes of Rudolf Bultmann suggested the miracles are just myths. And they stripped the story of its miraculous and offered a natural explanation. When they came to our story tonight of Jesus and Peter walking on the water, boy, they planned to have a field day. They sharpened their knives of criticism, and with glee, they read this story and they shouted, "Myth, nothing but a myth." The boat was simply near the water's edge, and Jesus merely walked ankle deep in the surf. I ask you, ladies and gentlemen, tonight, is that the case? I believe it isn't. This particular miracle tonight that we have read was recorded by three different gospel writers. Two of those gospel writers were, in fact, eyewitnesses, having been present in the boat at the time. Matthew, who was present in verse 24 of our reading, he tells us that the boat was, look at it, the boat was in the middle of the sea. There's a big difference between the edge of the sea and the middle of the sea. This man was there. This man was an eyewitness. This man is a primary source. And he says the boat was in the middle of the sea. In Mark's account, in Mark chapter 6 and verse 47, and Mark wasn't there, but Mark gets all his information for his gospel from the apostle Peter, who was there. Mark says in Mark 6 and 47, the boat was now in the middle of the sea. John, in John chapter 6 and verse 19, he says this, and again, John was present in the boat at the time. John says they had rowed for about 3 to 4 miles when they saw Jesus walking on the water. Now, maybe you have never been to the Sea of Galilee. I had the privilege of being there in 2004. And the Sea of Galilee, ladies and gentlemen, it is 13 miles long, it is 8 miles wide, and in the middle, it is 43 meters deep. So what am I trying to say tonight? This miracle didn't happen by the shore. It happened in the middle of the Sea of Galilee. They had rowed 3 to 4 miles. They were in the middle, and beneath them was approximately 43 meters depth of water. Ladies and gentlemen, something else. If by some chance they were just a few yards from the shore and it was only ankle deep, could you please explain to me the panic and the terror of the experienced Peter, an experienced fisherman, if they were only ankle deep? I suggest to you, sir and lady, tonight that the skeptic is wrong, wrong, and wrong. And this story is real, real, and real. Will you say, praise the Lord? Now, it's the fourth watch of the night. When is that? Somewhere between 3 o'clock and 6 o'clock in the morning. They're rowing across the Sea of Galilee. And one of the disciples spots something. What's that? I can see him pointing. I can see him squinting. What's that? The rest of the disciples follow his gaze. They follow in the direction he is pointing, and there they see a figure. Yeah, a ghostly figure illuminated by the moon, walking on the surface of the water, 3 to 4 miles from the shore, about 43 meters depth of water beneath him. Their surprise quickly turns to fear. It's a spirit. It's a ghost. It's a phantom. And Matthew confesses they were troubled. Now, don't be too harsh on them tonight, because if you had been in that boat, I'll guarantee you that you also would have been troubled. It's not every night you're sailing across the Sea of Galilee and something supernatural is occurring just off the port side. They were thinking, who or what walks on water? What is it? What can it be? To them, it could only be a spirit. To them, it could only be a ghost hovering over the surface of the water. But they forgot. There's another answer. There's something else. There's someone else who can walk on the surface of the water. Who would that be? Almighty God. Job the patriarch, in Job chapter 9 and verse 8, and he's speaking in that verse about the Almighty. He's speaking about God, and Job says that God, listen, spreads out the heavens, listen, and he treads, or he walks the waves of the sea. What was Jesus doing walking on the sea? Why was he doing this? Why was he walking on the sea? I'll tell you why he was walking on the sea. He was making a point, and he was demonstrating to those disciples that he was God. Job says, God walks on the waters. Jesus says, now listen, guys, you watch here. You're going to learn something about me. I'm more than the prophet from Galilee. I'm more than the virgin son. I am God Almighty, and I'll prove it. I'll walk on the water. Then the figure called to them. And the figure said to them with a familiar voice, be of good cheer. It is I. Do not be afraid. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight, let's just stop here for a second. That must have been some sight. That must have been something awesome. That must have been some sight to have seen Jesus walking on the water. Friends, tonight, people have said that man's greatest achievement was when man walked on the moon. I want to say to you tonight, there was something greater than man walking on the moon. What was it? It was God walking on the water. Will you say amen? Who's walking on the water? Almighty God, clothed and wrapped in a body of flesh. And he calls to them with a familiar voice, be of good cheer. It is I. Do not be afraid. Notice those three little words. It is I. As casual as you like. He knows they're terrified. He knows there's panic. He knows there's consternation. He knows all that. And he says, listen, be of good cheer. It's I. It is I. Do you not know? It is I. Oh, they had watched him only a few hours earlier multiply the fish and the bread and to feed the 5,000 men plus the women plus the children that came with the men and the women. They'd watched him do many things. He says, listen, it's me. It's me. He says, it is I. The English translation of it is I is a poor rendering of the original. The original Greek reads ego emi, which literally means I am. So what did Jesus actually say to them as he drew near to the boat? He says, be of good cheer. I am. Do not be afraid. Notice that. I am. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight, that is an echo back to Moses at the burning bush centuries earlier. When Moses asked God at the burning bush what his name was, the Almighty replied, I am. The one now who was walking the waves identified himself using the divine name. And he further used the divine name when he said, I am the bread of life. When he said, I am the good shepherd. When he said, I am the door. When he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. When he said, I am the true vine. When he said, I am the resurrection and the life. And when he said to the Pharisees, before Abraham was, I am. Do you see this Jesus that we love in our church? Do you see this Jesus that we sing to? Do you see this Jesus that we worship and we talk about with such joy and enthusiasm? He's more than a prophet. He's more than a teacher. He's more than the founder of another religion. He is God of very God, from everlasting to everlasting. God manifested in the flesh. That's why we love him. Will you say, praise the Lord? The one we're talking about tonight is not a mere mortal. He is immortal. He is God manifested in flesh. Now, Matthew informs us that the boat was tossed by the waves, for the wind was contrary. Mark says they were straining at rowing, for the wind was against them. And John, in his account of the story, says that a great wind was blowing. I thought about that on Friday morning as I was writing this. I thought about it. I said to myself, That's strange. Pastor, why do you think that's strange? One of the greatest storms they'd ever faced, and yet they were in the perfect will of God. Think about it. They were in one of the fiercest storms that they had ever encountered, and yet they were in the perfect will of God. Why? Because Jesus had commanded them to sail to the other side, and they were fully obeying. And yet Jesus allows this storm to beset them. Now listen, don't you blame the devil for this storm. It was Jehovah who allowed this storm. They were right in the perfect will of God, and he allowed this storm. Why does God allow storms to come into the lives of his children and his people? You know, the devil gets the blame for an awful lot of stuff he's got nothing to do with. Why does God allow storms to come into the lives of his people, of those who follow him? Well, sometimes, as in the case of Jonah, it is in order to chasten a disobedient child of his. You see, that's what the story of Jonah is all about. Jonah's four little chapters, and if you ask the average person what the book of Jonah is about, they say, oh, that's about Jonah and the whale. Listen, it's not about Jonah and the whale. Jonah and the whale is there The story is about how God deals with a wayward, rebellious, disobedient child. Yeah? My dad loved me. Loved me with a passion. I was his firstborn. But there was many a time my dad scalped my backside. Do you know why? Because I was out of order. Because I was out of line. And he did not plan to rear a brat. He wanted me to grow up straight in a crooked world. And he said, son, you can do it the easy way or you can do it the hard way. And Jonah decided that he would be disobedient. And God says, I can't allow that. Oh, yes, I'm a protecting father. Oh, yes, I'm a providing father. Oh, yes. But I'm also a father who will chasten my children, whom I love, that they'll turn up straight. In Jonah chapter 1 and verse 4, it tells us, but the Lord sent out a great wind on the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea. So sometimes God sends a storm into your life in order to get you back in line. Am I speaking to someone tonight who's out of line? Am I speaking to someone tonight and you know in your heart of hearts and you're in here tonight and you can cover it up and you can deceive everyone, but you know in your heart of heart tonight that you're out of line with God. God has ways of bringing you back into line. He sent a storm after Jonah. And maybe the storm that you're facing tonight and maybe the storm that you're going through, God has allowed it. His purpose is not to harm you. His purpose is not to destroy you. His purpose is not to wreck you. His purpose is to bring you back into line because he loves you. Will you say amen? But other times, God sends a storm to test things. The storm in Jesus' story in Matthew chapter 7 tested what foundation each house was built on. You see, it took a storm, not good weather. It took a storm to prove the strength of one foundation and the weakness of another foundation. And sometimes, brothers and sisters, tonight, God allows storms to come into our experiences. He allows those storms sometimes to rock our boats. Why? In order to prove us, in order to develop us, in order to produce a thing called character. Jesus didn't want to harm these disciples, but it was time. It was time for their faith to grow. It was time for them to grow. It was time for them to develop. I have learned, brothers and sisters, in over 40 years of following Jesus, I have discovered that I learn more about myself and I learn more about God's ways and God's dealings with me in the storm rather than the calm. Do you know something? You learn nothing in the calm. You learn nothing when things are going easy for you. But you learn plenty in the storm. And you learn plenty when things are tight. So if you're here tonight and you're a child of God and you find yourself in a storm, I want you to stop asking God to get you out of the storm. Instead, you need to say to him, Lord, what lesson are you trying to teach me in this storm? Perhaps that's the reason why you're going through what you're going through tonight. Because the Savior who loves you, the Savior who died for you, wants to develop you, wants you to draw you closer and nearer to himself. Maybe that's the reason why you're going through what you're going through. But let's go on tonight. We need to hurry. Verse 29 of our story, we read these words. And when Peter had come down out of the boat, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. Now, brothers and sisters, I know Peter is often ridiculed for sinking. Because you know the story. In a few minutes, we'll come to that point in the story where he takes his eye off Jesus and he gets fixated with a storm and he starts to sink. And when preachers preach in this story, listen, they're sore on Peter. They give Peter a rough time. But brothers and sisters, I actually think that in this instance, Peter should be admired. Now, why do I say that? Because whether you like it or not, for a short time, he defied the laws of nature and he walked on the water. He believed and he was enabled to do what nature's laws says is impossible. Don't be harsh on him. Don't be sore on him. I think actually he needs a pat on the back. I think actually he needs a congratulatory handshake because he actually walked on the water. And here's something else. Peter did what the likes of Andrew and Bartholomew and Judas and Matthew didn't do. All them other guys, they stayed in the boat. They stayed in the boat pontificating. They stayed in the boat going through theology. But Peter instead throws a leg over the side of the boat and he takes a huge step of faith. When was the last time you took a step of faith? When was the last time you stopped playing safe and instead took a step of faith? It seems to me that today there are too many believers playing it safe and staying in the boat. Are you one of those believers, brother? Are you one of those believers, sister? And tonight, you're playing it safe. You're staying in the boat. Do you know something? We could play it safe. We could stay in the boat instead of putting on a live Belfast. People have said, well, what are you doing that for? The people who said, what are you doing that for? They're stuck in the boat. They're stuck in the boat. Yes, brothers and sisters, we could play safe and just let it all happen and not stretch ourselves and not do anything different. We could make lots of excuses for not having a mission, but no. You see, we need to get out of the boat and do something to reach those tonight who are perishing. And the church has forgot that all around us tonight, there are men and there are women and there are young men and there are young women and there are boys and there are girls, and they are perishing. And the church wants to play safe and stay in church and have nice meetings. Pastor Frankie was telling us on Friday that in the last 2 to 3 weeks, 13 individuals within a square mile of this church have committed suicide. And the church wants to stay in the boat. The church wants to play safe. The church wants to stay in the comfort zone. Brothers and sisters, we need to get out of the boat. We need to get out of being comfortable and get out of our comfortable surroundings. We need to get out and we need to step in the water. Will you say, praise the Lord? Brother and sister, tonight, look at me. Why over the next 2 to 3 weeks don't you take a step of faith? Come on. Why over the next 2 to 3 weeks 2 weeks' time, we'll be in the middle of the mission. 2 weeks' time, God willing, David Hamm will be here preaching. Why over the next 2 to 3 weeks doesn't every single one of us take a step of faith? Distribute leaflets. Come on, will you take a step of faith on Tuesday night? Come on. Oh, Pastor, I have sore knees. Oh, Pastor, I have a sore back. Stay in the boat. Stay in the boat. Oh, Pastor, we go to the bowls club on Tuesday night. Stay in the boat. Oh, Pastor, that's the night we go to Asda to do the week's shopping. Stay in the boat. That's what that's called, staying in the boat. Tuesday night, why don't you take a step of faith and turn up here at 6:30 and give out leaflets for a mission? Will you say amen tonight? Amen. Why don't you give a love gift next Sunday to pay for the mission? Why don't you bring a sacrifice? Oh, Pastor, times are hard and the Lord expects us to be careful what we do with our money. Oh, brothers and sisters, where on earth would we be tonight if he had played it safe and didn't go to Calvary for us? Come on, why don't you take a step next Lord's Day and bring a sacrifice? Bring something that'll hurt. Do you believe that the Lord is no man's debtor? Because whatever you give to him, he'll give it back to you in 100 different ways. That's called taking a step of faith. That's called getting out of the boat and walking on the water. Why don't you go to someone? Why don't you go to someone face to face and just tell them, listen, friend, Jesus loves you. Pastor, they'll think I'm crazy. Sure, they'll think you're crazy anyway. You may as well give them a reason for thinking you're crazy. Brothers and sisters, go and tell them that Jesus loves them. Go and tell them that they need Jesus. Come on, it's time to get out of the boat. What boat do you need to get out of tonight? What sea do you need to walk on? In God's lovely and in God's precious name, brother and sister, get out of the boat, and just as he enabled Peter, he will enable you to walk on your water. Will you say amen? Let's hurry up. Oh, look at the time tonight. Oh, boy. We're not told how far Peter walked from the boat. But with his vision fixed on Jesus, he progressed. I don't know how long he walked. Was it just a few seconds? Was it maybe close to a minute? I don't know. How far did he walk? I don't know. Frustrates me. I want to know. Did he walk a few yards? Did he walk maybe 20, 30, 40 meters? I don't know. But brothers and sisters, with his vision fixed on Jesus, he walked on the water. But then verse 30 tells us, when he saw that the wind was boisterous, listen, he was afraid and beginning to sink. What was it? Was it a gust of wind? Was it a deafening clap of thunder that distracted him? But in a moment, his gaze shifted from Jesus, and now instead, his eyes are on the storm, his eyes are on the black clouds, his eyes are on the waves, and instead, brothers and sisters, instead of Jesus, and he loses his sea legs, and he starts to sink. Now, I wonder how long that took. When I was on holiday, I jumped into the swimming pool, and from my feet touching the water to my head being under the water, it was but a second. Peter starts to sink. Brothers and sisters, tonight, from this side to the other side, you see, they were going from one side of the Sea of Galilee to the other side. Brothers and sisters, from one side to the other side, between now and heaven, we're going to face many a storm. Many times the wind is going to be contrary. It's good when the wind is at your back, isn't it? But many a time the wind is in our face. Many a time the wind is contrary. What are you going to do?
What are you going to do? Brothers and sisters, I'll tell you what you don't do. You never, never, no, never, you never take your eyes off Jesus. Amen? Amen? That's a simple little lesson. We've heard that many, many times over the years. You never, ever take your eyes off Jesus. It doesn't matter if the skies above you are black and threatening, or the wind is in your face, or the waves are breaking against you, or even the eye of the storm engulfs you. Listen, you never, 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 never take your eyes off Jesus. It was only that moment when Peter took his eyes off Jesus that he started to sink. Am I speaking to someone tonight who's sinking? Am I speaking to someone who's taken their eyes off Jesus? Some storm has come into your life, perhaps the death of a loved one. Perhaps some terrible news. Perhaps something terrible, something dreadful has happened to you. Listen to me, whatever you do, don't take your eyes off Jesus. What storm are you in tonight? Get your eyes off the storm and put your eyes on the one who calms the storm. Will you say, praise the Lord? Never, ever take your eyes off Jesus. He's your rock when all around you is sinking sand. He's your strong tower when the enemy is pressing around you. He's your great shepherd when that old lion, the devil, is on the prowl. He's your refuge in the storm. He's your shield from the fiery darts of the wicked one. Am I speaking to someone tonight and you're in a storm and you feel you're sinking? Are circumstances crashing into your faith? Are circumstances bashing your faith? Listen, never, never, never take your eyes off Jesus. Take your eyes off the preacher. Take your eyes off Christians. Take your eyes off the church. But don't you ever dare take your eyes off Jesus. But Peter took his eyes off Jesus, and that experienced disciple, that disciple who had heard tremendous sermons from Jesus, he'd heard the Sermon on the Mount, he'd seen tremendous miracles. He takes his eyes off Jesus, and he started to sing. Do you know tonight, as I finish, do you know tonight that Ulster is absolutely full to the brim with backsliders? Did you know that? I could count easily 100, 200 backsliders that I have known over the years. Pastor, why did the backslide? Well, there's many reasons, but ultimately they all have one thing in common. Every one of them at some point, they took their eyes off Jesus. Is there someone here tonight and you've taken your eyes off Jesus? Is there someone here tonight and you've took your eyes off Jesus? Something terrible happened, something bad happened. And in that storm, you took your eyes off Jesus and you looked at the storm and you looked at the situation and you looked at what was happening. And when you did that, you started to sink. Peter took his eyes off Jesus and he started to sink. We sing a chorus. Somebody sang it, I think, the other night. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and his grace. There's people here tonight looking at me and listening to me, and tonight you need to put your eyes back on Jesus or you're going to drown. I'll finish with this. As he's sinking, in that second, he shouts out in panic,
Lord, save me. One of the shortest prayers in the entire Bible. 3 words. Lord, save me. One of the shortest prayers, but one of the most effective prayers that was ever prayed. 3 words. Lord, save me. And we're told, and immediately. Jesus didn't wait. Immediately, he stretched forth his hand and saved him. Friend, tonight, are you sinking? Friend, tonight, did you take your eyes off Jesus? Listen, in your seat tonight, call out to him. Maybe you're in a storm tonight. Listen, in that storm, call out to him. Peter was in a storm, but Jesus heard his voice in the storm. Call out to him. What do you say to him? Why don't you just say what Peter said? Lord, will you save me? Save me from my sin. Save me from myself. Save me from my wickedness. Save me from what I've got myself messed up in. Save me from my backsliding. Save me. Do you know what'll happen? Do you know what'll happen? You won't have to wait till you get home. You won't have to wait to come back next week. You know what'll happen? And immediately, he'd stretch out his hand and he'd save you. Just as he saved Peter, he'd save you. Pastor, does it work? There's hundreds of people here tonight. And one night, they just said those 3 words, Lord, save me. And do you know what happened? He saved them. And they're still here tonight. And they're still in the boat. Jesus ushers Peter back into the boat. And the disciples are gobsmacked. They've never seen the likes of this. And we're told that they fell down and they worshiped him. And they said, truly, you are the Son of God. But do you know something? Do you know what I think was happening as they were doing that? Jesus put his arm around Peter. And he pulled Peter into him. And there's the disciples worshiping him. Truly, you're the Son of God. He puts his arm around Peter and he pulls Peter in. This is what he says to Peter. Now you listen to me. Don't you ever take your eyes off me again. Brother and sister tonight, maybe you've taken your eyes off him. And you're starting to sink. Just call out to him where you are. Just call out to him where you're sitting tonight. Call out to him. Doesn't matter who you are. Whether you're here for the first time or the 100th time. If you feel tonight this message is for you and God is speaking to you, then you call out to him and just say, Lord, save me. And I promise you on his word, he will save you for his glory and for your good. And everybody say,
cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior. Cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by every stone. Messiah still. Oh,
forgot to say, those two men who raised their hands, and the service finishes, go into the room, we call the McGee room. I saw Pastor Irwin nipping out. Just go there. There's someone to give you literature and a CD about what it means to come to Christ and what happens. And if there's anyone else here tonight and you want to be saved, listen, I'm one of the last to leave. Just come and say hello. See any of our pastors, and if we can help you, all we desire is to be a blessing. Pastor Jim, amen.
Lord, we thank you for your awesome presence in this place tonight. Lord, we never tire of singing your praises. We want to sing them endlessly and exalt and glorify the name of our great and loving God. And Lord, we thank you tonight that you've honored your promise. We're willing to praise you. You show up, you show out with your awesome presence, and you change and you touch hearts and lives. Lord, help us to take the exhortation from your word tonight, to never take our eyes off you. Help us, Lord, to take that step of faith, to get out of the boat and to exercise our faith and go forward in the plan and purpose and the will of God, regardless of the storms of life that surround us, and never take our eyes off you. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your presence tonight. Thank you for the fellowship of God's people. Take us safely from this place to our several homes, rejoicing in the sweet presence of a living God. And may we, in the week that lie ahead, bring honor and glory to your great and your awesome name. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and remain, abide upon us, until Jesus comes again. Amen. Turn around and say hello. Amen. Good night, everyone. God bless you.
Hello again. That was a lovely service that we had tonight. We had a great time of worship. The Cranwell Brothers sang a few songs, and they were brilliant, spoke of the love of Jesus and about how he shed his precious blood for each of us. And that was a challenging word that Pastor David brought tonight. And we're rejoicing over those two souls that came to know the Lord Jesus. And we're trusting and believing that God has also spoken through our online ministry. So if you have made that decision to follow Christ, please get into contact with us. And whether you're a believer or whether you're unsaved, maybe you feel like you're sinking, maybe you feel like you're in the middle of a storm and you can't make your way out of it, I would encourage you, just focus your eyes on Jesus tonight and ask him to help you and save you from whatever it is that you're facing. We have our online pastor, Pastor Irwin Ray, here ready to speak with you. So he's in the studio and we're going to hand over to him right now.
Thank you, Eden. Indeed, tonight was another precious night spent around the precious word of truth. And as Pastor David ministered tonight in that old story about the storm, you know, I just looked at my old Bible with some wee notes I'd jotted down, and one of the wee thoughts was this: that which was their trial was Christ's footpath to get to them. Let me say that again. That which was their trial was Christ's footpath to get to them. And whatever it is you are going through in life, each one of us, families or friends or loved ones, church life, storms will always come. But thank God, storms go. It's the afterwards. And as Eden alluded to it tonight, I always think of the old hymn writer who said this: I was sinking deep in sin, sinking to rise no more. Then the master of the waves heard my despairing cry, and love lifted me. And this world tonight is going through a great storm. Look all over the world tonight, the nations, the countries, the politics, the governments, the storm of Armageddon. The coming of Christ is closer than we think. Let's keep our eyes on Christ. And here's a wee thought, and I'll leave it with you. Peter may have begun to sink because he took his eyes of the master. But thank God the master never took his eyes of Peter. And sir and lady tonight, maybe you feel that what you're going through, you're crying out to God and say, Lord, where are you? His eye is on the sparrow. The Lord bless you tonight. Pray and trust God's word has entered your heart and you come to the knowledge of salvation in Christ. God bless you.